Books on Tape presents Babyville, written by Jane Green, read by Kate Redding. Babyville. Julia. 1. Julia hoists herself around on the bed until her head's at the bottom, then sticks her legs straight up in the air and leans them gently on the headboard. "You know, you look ridiculous," Mark snorts, walking out of the bedroom to grab some toilet paper from the bathroom, because that is their deal. She will allow the wet spot to be on her side of the bed as long as Mark is the one to clean it up, and she is only allowing it at all because she is thrilled, delighted, amazed that Mark has even agreed to this baby in the first place. She was thrilled. 9 months ago. 9 months ago, when she first broached the subject and told him that she was desperate for a baby, that at 33 time was definitely running out, that her mother had problems conceiving her, and it took her 2.5 years. That last part was actually a bit of a white lie. Her mother conceived her on her wedding night, but that was the clincher, and Julia finally got her wish. She watches Mark as he comes back from the bathroom. Tallish, broadish, green-eyed and mousy-haired, he would produce adorable children. They together would produce adorable children. They would have Julia's dimples and Mark's eyes, Julia's hair and Mark's physique, Mark's gentleness, calmness, and Julia's tenacity, drive. They would have so much, if Mark and Julia were able to produce at all. 9 months. Ironic, isn't it? If they had been successful that first time they decided to leave the condoms in the drawer, they'd be having a baby right about now. To be more specific, Julia would be having a baby next Thursday. Thursday the 30th of January. He, or she, or baby of mine, as Julia had termed the life that isn't yet growing, would be an Aquarius. Her secret language of birthdays book says the following about people born on the 30th of January. Those commanding personalities born on the 30th of January are born to lead. They have a great talent for guiding, entertaining, teaching, explaining, and in general making their ideas clear to others. Julia's baby would have shared a birthday with Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Vanessa Redgrave, Gene Hackman, and a whole host of people allegedly famous but not worth repeating. But Franklin Delano Roosevelt? Well, you can just imagine what Julia's thinking. She lay in bed for hours that first night, eyes wide open, thinking about her son, the future Prime Minister, or her daughter, the next head of the United Nations. Not that she'd planned it, but really she had thought, is there a better sign in the galaxy? Baby of mine would have been lucky enough not to have inherited Mark's Cancerian moodiness or her dodgy Pisces sentimentality. According to Linda Goodman, Aquarian boys and girls can be calm and sweetly docile on the surface, but the north wind can turn them suddenly topsy-turvy. Expect your February child to have a dream, she says, and hold it fast until he gets another one. Your little Uranian is apparently very special. He's a humanitarian. He loves people. Do you know how rare that is? As society moves into the Aquarian age, his unprejudiced wisdom is leading us. Aquarian boys and girls have been chosen by destiny to fulfill the promises of tomorrow. All in all, not a bad deal. So, rather devastating that Julia's baby chose not to make an appearance. The first couple of months, it was no big deal. It only became a big deal when Sam, Julia's best friend, fell pregnant without even trying. Of course, Julia was delighted for her, could not have been happier or more excited, but somehow it raised the stakes, began to put pressure on, and suddenly Julia found this was no longer fun, this was business. For the first time in her life, she found herself failing at something. Julia had always been a golden girl. Through university, then into her first job on a graduate trainee scheme at London Daytime Television. Someone somewhere must have been smiling on her, because she was quickly promoted to the better series, and now she's the executive producer of a leading early evening chat show. Lunchtimes, she finds herself sitting with the president of entertainment. He digs his fork into her chicken for a taste, in a manner that implies equality and intimacy, and possibly more, although she's not interested. The head of drama, much to her continued amazement, calls Julia to bemoan her love life. They sit in the bar after work as production assistants try to worm their way into their affections by buying them drinks and feeding them office gossip. Of course, Julia has nothing to bemoan. This is what people say about her. I would like to be in her shoes. She has always had what everyone else has always wanted. From her glossy dark hair, easily her best feature, to her small feet tucked into beaded slippers or sexy pointed slingbacks. From her spotlighted career, she is regularly included in those magazine features on Ones to Watch, to her large Victorian house in Hampstead. Actually, it's Gospel Oak, but given that it's practically on top of the heath and that all the estate agents call it Hampstead, Julia is now doing the same thing. And, most of all, Mark. Julia and Mark met 4 years ago. He was the company lawyer, had been with the firm for about 6 months, had become the heartthrob of the office. Julia, to her credit, was blissfully unaware of this, being embroiled in a relationship with one of those dreadful, difficult men who pretend that they love you but who are actually far too busy with their friends and their lives to give you the time of day. Perhaps blissfully unaware is not quite true. She was vaguely aware of a new lawyer who had set hearts a-fluttering, and vaguely aware that her fellow female researchers kept dashing upstairs to get something legaled that was quite patently legal in her opinion, and even though she knew she had met Mark, had even spoken to him, she didn't think of him as a man. And then one lunchtime he came and stood by Julia's table, an overflowing plate of spaghetti threatening to tip off his tray, and asked if he could join her. She was Miss Doom and Gloom, having realized that the dreadful, difficult man was turning out to be too dreadfully difficult even for her. But within minutes, Mark had made her smile. The first time she had smiled for weeks. Julia never bothered ringing the dreadful, difficult man to tell him it was over. Then again, he never phoned her either. She is sometimes tempted, 4 years on, to ring and say the relationship doesn't seem to be working just for a laugh. But even though the thought makes her smile from time to time, it's not something she would ever actually do. They were friends for a while, Julia and Mark. She was working all hours researching a fly-on-the-wall documentary about women having plastic surgery. Mark was at that point the junior lawyer. He pretended he was also working late and would go to her office to persuade her to get a bite to eat after work. But gorgeous as everyone else seemed to find him, Mark simply wasn't her type. Even now, she's not entirely sure he's her type. She tells people she fell in like with him, because he was kind to her and treated her well, and because he was such a nice guy. And maybe, just maybe, because she was slightly on the rebound, although the only person she's ever admitted that to is Sam. And if that were really true, there's no way she'd be with him 4 years on, is there? Is there? They still work together. And everyone still loves him. The researchers, much like policemen, may be getting younger and younger, but they still cluster round in excitement as he passes, or scurry down the corridor to his office, an endless stream of fluffy blonde chicks, desperate to impress. It makes Julia smile. It always did. Thankfully, she is not the jealous or suspicious type. They say the ones you have to watch are the quiet ones. That it is always the ones who are least likely to have the affairs that end up having the affairs, and sometimes Julia thinks this will be the case with Mark. But the truth is that she doesn't really care. If Mark had an affair, she's not sure she could even be bothered to deal with it. Maybe she would. Maybe it would be an excuse to end it. Not that she's unhappy exactly, but she's not happy either. She just is. For the last couple of years, Julia has felt as if she's lived her life floating on a cloud of apathy, and she's really not certain what the problem is. Everyone tells her she's the luckiest girl in the world, and Mark did everything for her, although now when she catches his eye as they sit on the sofa watching television, it shocks her to recognize herself in there. She turns away and blinks, unable to bear the thought that Mark is equally numb, because if that is the case, then what is the point? A baby is the point, she decided 9 months ago, when the numbness threatened to overwhelm her. Because while she may not be entirely happy with Mark, while they may not make each other laugh any more, while they hardly talk any more except to argue and they don't even manage to do that properly, Mark being the gentle, non-confrontational creature that he is, while she refuses to acknowledge that surely there is. There must be more to life than this. There are things about Mark that she loves. She loves the fact that he will make a wonderful...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.